Alright, so I'm not sure how long this is going to go, so we're just going to talk until they kick us out. We are going to talk about out of system. We're going to talk a little bit about the theory of why we do things in our gym, and then we will show you guys some drills of how you can train out of system at the beginning of practice, how you can do some layering drills, and then what like a 6-on-6 kind of concept of out of system would look like. Fingers crossed we'll get through it all. Alright, so in our gym, because we run a fast offense, the way that we have our hitters keep track of when they go is on step counts. So in system, they're on their first step in a three-step approach. Out of system, they're on a first step in a four-step approach. If you guys don't want to do that, that's completely fine, because out of system is kind of like wait and go. So for us, the first thing that we need to figure out is how high we want out of system balls to be. So we run this warm-up drill. It's really a defensive drill, but it also works on out of system setting. So can they get someone in the left back and right back? And then Ryan, can you be where Colleen is? One of you guys can be where I am. Yep, one of you guys can be right here. Alright, so we're gonna slowly walk you through this. This is a warm-up drill that we use with our littles when they're separated. So it's pretty much a two-person pepper, really. So you are going to hit cross-court for today, you're just gonna underhand toss. Alright, so you're going to pass to L. Okay. L, you're going to set to Ryan. Okay, so you're going to set cross. Okay, Ryan's going to hit at you. Okay, then you're going to dig. Then you're going to set cross. Okay, she's going to hit at you. Okay, and so let's slowly go through this and see what it looks like. And then we'll talk about, yep. You guys can just catch and we'll pretend you're going to hit. So you can catch. Alright, so super easy warm-up drill. Some of the things that we talk to our girls about is where we want these out-of-system balls to be. Okay, and more of people, and then you guys can catch and toss it on the head. So, no, not you though. All your life. So for us in our gym, we really like to try to train game-like skills. So the reason we have this set up in left and right back is L should be starting in base. Okay. When she sets Ryan, okay, wherever she is, she needs to then push back into our defense position. You have to dig the ball high to the middle, because that's where we always dig our out of system balls to. Then Sarah's gonna make a perfect out of system set wherever she is, and she's gonna push back, play defense, okay, dig high to the middle. So trying to rep game-like situations. So when we talk to the kids about how high these balls are, some of our kids will chuck them to the ceiling. Okay, for us, because our libero is pretty strong, when she platform passes, she'll actually platform pass in system. Or other kids, we just tell them to kind of like chuck it to the ceiling. So whatever standard you guys want in your gym, I would encourage you, whenever we're doing a drill, to try to make these out-of-system sets the exact same height. So whether you guys are peppering, whether you're doing the net stuff, whether you're doing a simple warm-up drill like this, all these out-of-system sets should look the exact same. And stop. Good job, guys. All right, so once we've established what height we want our out-of-system sets to be, one of the layering drills that we do all the time. Sarah. I'm going to call you Stacy the whole time. And so Sarah's going to be our center. Okay? Are you good? You good at being a center? Okay. So you got to take Ryan's spot. Ryan, can you be on the other side? Right back. All right, so in this drill, we have two hitters. So L is our outside. Okay. I'm sorry, what's your name? Chris. Chris is our right side. So we like to put in randomness into drills. So what we're going to do is Ryan is either going to toss to the center, okay, who's then going to pass to herself, set either pin, be out of system. Okay? Does that make sense? So if she tosses to the center, you're going to pass to herself, set either pin out of system. Okay? If you pass to the outside, it's just like serve receive, she will pass to the center of the net, and then center you can set in system both ways. Okay? Okay, so we're taking a really simple concept and layering it. If the layer is too much, then I would just tell the center to set out a system one way. So if you have a line of kids here, okay, toss in the center line, could only set outside, basically. So then what you would have is you have a line here, so you would toss into the center, so you would ask yourself, set out a system, that will transition up to the bottom. Okay, and then you have a line of kids going through, going through, going through. Okay, if you want to layer it, then do the same thing, say snow, set both pins. Oh, now pin system. Ryan's being tricky. Ryan's being tricky.
Wait, I can do
it.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's upset. All right, so once you guys start going through this, if the layer is too much, then you roll it back and you isolate one spot. Because we had to do this in our gym. We set this drill up, we told them, look, we have three layers that we're trying to work through. If we can't do a game-like, we just roll it back. So we had to roll it back to just the outside. Okay, then we put in both pins. Then we put in a system out of system. Okay, then we added blockers on the other side, okay? Instead of Ryan tossing, have an actual live serve. You can put an extra person back here to mimic another servicing person. So you just keep adding layers depending on how quickly your girls advance. Does that make sense? Any questions? Okay. All right, so we do this in station. So once we develop what we want our system to be, once we develop what our footwork is gonna be out of the system, this would be a station where we split our kids on two courts. We want to wrap like out of system. Okay, a warm-up drill that we use, Ryan, can you be over here? I'll be on the other side. Yeah. All right, so a warm-up drill that we use, four and four, for right now, I'm just gonna show it to you on one side. Okay, so the only rule that we have is if the front row, the only rule is if the front row gets the second ball, they have to send the ball over. Okay, so what we're trying to do is make this an out-of-system game, where the back row set in, two live pins out of system, and you'd have four people playing it out on this side. Okay, we call it the box game because they're set up in a box. All right, so, just jump and catch. All right, so when we toss, you should be passing to the back row, be setting high out of system, okay, so that he'll hit, and the exact same thing happens on this side. Okay, pass to the front row for some reason. All right, so if not to pass to her. All right, so if the front row gets the second ball, then they have to send it over. Okay, so it's a little bit of randomness to create out-of-system situations. If you didn't put that in, what would happen is they would just pass in front, tip over all the time, and you would lose reps from what you're actually trying to do. So we set up this drill to force them out of system, and if they pass to the net, then they have to send the ball over. Okay, we play this 25. We toss balls in, we toss the winner, okay? The issue that you might run into in this drill is if you haven't layered yet, and you haven't established what you want your out-of-system to be, the footwork that you want, that this might be kind of a cluster. That is okay if they're working through it, but if you really want to hone the technique, I would roll this back before they get to this. But this is a warm-up drill that we would use for out-of-system. Make sense? Any questions? Okay. All right, so what I want, L, I'll come over here really quick, and then give me Ryan to balance her safely. Actually, I'll bring you back in. All right, so not a rod assistant drill that we do in the station, okay? So L will be serving. Both wings are live. Okay, so what we do is whoever's in the middle is going to be the center. Okay, so it'd be a live serve, just toss. So when we train our passers, we just tell them to pass high into the middle court. Okay, so whether we have a center or not, it's high to the middle. So toss the ball over. You're going to pass high to the middle. Person in the middle is going to set. Okay, both pins. Hit the ball over. Okay, and then rep through. Number wise, rest. You can do it this way. I just keep tossing them. So you can have a lie in the back where whoever hits rotates off, whoever's off rotates in. You just have rapid fire surveys. If you have multiple courts going, I would have everyone going the same way. Once they get the concept, job done. Once you get the concept, then you can put this in the queens. Okay, so this is now that they are in queens. The reason that we like to do a skill to initiate, because our game is so random, trying to dictate everything that they do kind of defeats the purpose of our learning. So we want to train out a system. The very first ball we have a system that we let them play. If we wanted to train running the middle, the first ball we running the middle to them, we let them play. So you can put them in queens, kids will love it. But if you want to work on how to system in a queen setting, okay, make the first ball be out of system like this, okay, and then you can have them. And you rotate the same way through. The other thing you can do is you can build on. So in our gym, you can add on, if you didn't want to do queens, you wanted to be more system, you can have a live block on the other side. So working on what the block needs to do when they recognize out of system. You can then put a live six on the other side. So it's a controlled defensive drill. So you're working on out of system on this side, you're working on a system defense on the other side. Okay, so that's nine people already on the court. Still have people off. So if you have two courts, you're already talking 18 to 24 kids, okay, that you can get in a drill like this. So depending on where your kids are, those little layers that you can kind of go through. You can push them as far as they want, but the biggest thing, especially in our gym, is making sure that we're not relying on the drill to teach our kids. Because we run into this all the time, that they'll be going at it, we'll set it up, it's like, oh, this is great, we're working on out of system on this side, we'll have a live six, we're working on out of system defense on the other side, and then, you know, we're not transitioning to make an out of system attack, or blockers, or doing anything right, or defense making drops. So make sure that you are very diligent in keeping the kids doing what you want to all the time. I think that's the best way I can say it. All right? So let's talk a little bit about like a theory, theory of our out of system. So like I was saying, when we set up drills, when we're in our team settings, we passed our skill development, which we passed our stations. When we're in our team setting, we want to train out of system. A lot of the things that we will do is make the first ball out of system. So if you're playing 6-on-6, the easiest way to do it is to enter the ball to the center. And after that, just let them go. All right, so you're making the first ball out of system. So you're getting an out of system look right away, and then they will play. Okay, so if you want that to be the focus, I would, if that first ball isn't executed properly, then I would stop, and then I would skill correct. So on either side, if the set isn't good, the hit isn't good, the defense isn't lining up like they're supposed to out of system, stop, self-correct, then go. The reason we do that is because if we did in the middle of the play and we ask them 5 points later, you know, what'd you think about that? They have no idea. And so whatever skill that you guys want to do, try to do it right away. The easiest way for us to do it, put the center back rows, actually. I'll come over here for you. Let's go right for you. So if they had 6 people on court, easiest way to do it, send the ball to the center. Passing the barrel. It's the easiest way to do it. Send it to the center, should pass high in the middle, the barrel steps in, out of system, breathing. Okay, so that is what we see most of the time. The other way to do it, come center front row. So make your off blocker move. So same thing, you tip to the center passes high in the middle, the barrel steps in. Okay, for us, I would not mix the two. Because there are two distinct things, whether it's a three-hitter offense or a two-hitter offense. So rep one, where everyone gets a chance to go through. So in our gym, we will enter it in this way, okay, X number of balls, and then we'll rotate. So all of our outsides will go through the front, all of our middles will go through the middle front. Then to the number of reps that they will need. Make sense? Okay. When we are game playing and we're having the kids dictate, so instead of us tossing, the kids are dictating how fast to go, so they're going back and serve, receive. The way that we have the knowledge out of system is trying to get back in the system. Okay, most of our games played out of system. So what we don't want is to reinforce bad habits. So if we tell them, you know, we're gonna score a point every time you hit out of system, like our kids will literally like pass that on purpose, okay, which defeats the purpose of the drill. So what we want to do is we want to give them points of when they're out of system, how quickly they can get back in the system. So if you're playing a game in 25, what I'd do is I'd give a bonus point for every time they get back in system and score. Okay? For high school, that might be a lot. So what I would do is every time they get back in system, I'll give them a point. Okay, so start small and then build up. Alright, it's really hard to tell kids, let's score every time we hit the ball out of system, because they were literally just pass bad on purpose to try to get the point. So try to keep it as game-like and intentional as possible, but with the intent that you want. Does that make sense? Fine, okay, good. Do you have any questions so far? So, in our gym, last year our middles were blocking middles. So, out of system, we set the pins 99% of the time. We will train our setters in a 6-on-6 setting to push middle. So, what we consider a good pass, that's a really good question. So, I don't know if you guys can graffiti your floor. We put tape all over our floor. Okay, one thing we do is we put a box in the middle of the court. Anything inside this box, we consider a 3-pass. Okay, and it'll be from edge of the basketball circle, okay, to about where Ryan's standing, all the way over to where the 31 would be, okay, to the net. So anywhere in that box, we need to be running 3-hitters. So, Ryan, step all the way off to where you were. So we consider this in the system. Okay, so we will train our middles to create space, run threes, we call them Bs, okay? I'm gonna push it. So, if you can develop that in the station, same concept out of system. So if he gets pulled, you know, one more step off, I mean, for us, it's technically a 2-pass, but if they already have the understanding that this is how I need to push my middle, then they can push it from here. We really don't like our center to do it, because for us, it's better to throw a high ball to our all-conference outside than to our freshman middle. But that's how I would train. That's how I train pushing middles out of system.
Just standing there, kind of doing this, and it doesn't look like they're involved at all. And that's creating that habit. So Justin mentioned we have younger middles. By the time they're juniors and seniors, we want our center to force that middle. So if they don't drive, follow the ball, get up, understand the spatial awareness, they're not growing and learning either. So I think that's a great question. And you also have younger players, and they're big girls. If you don't tell them what to do, they're not going to understand how to do it. True story, we have two middles this year that never served a ball in high school or club. And that's a travesty for these taller players. And we need some of them to serve. So we put our middles throughout the ball control drills we've shown you the entire this clinic. We expect our middles to drive and to be able to move the ball around. You guys were in our short, right before lunch, we did with the boys team, we did short court. That's a great drill for middles to be involved in the net. We expect them to get out of the way, but they don't know how to get out of the way. They're big. They're tall, they're not as agile as some of the other positions. So we hope that they get set down the road. We train them to open their shoulders and be a part of the game and follow the ball and get out of the setter's way, and at some point get set. It might not be this season, but it's gonna be in the future. And you're doing us a service by actually encouraging that, so when we get them, they don't play like big middles that don't know what to do out of the system.
I really like
So, that's a good question. So, if our middles are transitioning how they should be back here by the time that the center is making contact. So, I mean, they're effectively ready to run around. We would never set them from the libero spot, but they would be in the middle of the court, transitioned off. So they're not making the decision at the net. That their decision for them is as soon as the ball clears them that they're going to drive and push off, and then once they see the pass, then decide. So that would effectively they'll be in the middle of the court. Does that make sense? To answer your question.
So they would not transition in that situation. They're not actually driving to get set because they're not knowing.
Right. Yeah.
Does everybody understand what he's asking? It's a great question.
We ran into this Wednesday in practice. We set up a drill that we thought was going to be a really good transition drill. What wound up happening is our middles wouldn't transition because they knew they weren't getting set. So we were reinforcing that habit. So we went to the office. We didn't scrap the drill, but we added an extra layer to protect it. So the middles had to transition when the ball went over every single time. So regardless of what like the next step is, we still wanted to be as game-like as possible. So we have to make game-like moves. The trap that we fall into, even with our staff, is when we set up a drill and we don't have everyone on the court. So I'll do this for me. Go left, block, left front, right front. Yeah, on right side. So Ryan, go left front, and then I'll go right front. On the outside, there you go. All right, so if we're doing a drill where we're only setting the pins, right? We're trying to rep, give them a look against blockers. What happens is the blockers don't go to their base, okay? They don't make the prep step because they don't have to honor a middle, okay? They know where the ball's going. So what we had to do is we had to put in an extra person running around. So, Stacy? Yes.
Fair.
That was not on purpose. Alright, so if Sarah's running outside, so we're like, Otis is passing, right? So Elle is just going and going, just releasing. What we found out is we had to add more to it. Chris. So we had to have Chris run in middle routes. So run like a B, run 31. So run right at Elle. Go that way. You walk towards her. So we had to add an extra route in to keep our blocker honest, so it actually looked like a game line where we have to protect, a HUD and a 31 coming at them. So we try to take layers out to protect them, but we realized that we were giving them really bad reps. We had to put it back in a game-like situation. So we're talking about what the middle is doing. You have to protect the transition. And even though it's out of system, if they're just working on, as soon as they clear, pushing off, that's what's protecting them to not reinforce bad habits. That answer. Our center is 5'7". She also led the nation in assists, but she's very small. She would not be an offensive option. So if she picked up the ball, we'd tell her, pass high to the middle, and the libero would have two options. You have a pin and have a pipe. There are other programs, Central, who has a lefty that can thump. So, if she takes the first ball, she's an option all the time. And so it just depends on your personnel. If you have a kid, especially in high school, that like can set and hit 100%, she takes the first ball, transition off the net, and let her be an option. So it's possible. Saginaw does it, but when we start just looking at numbers and percentages, we have a wealth of information at our disposal. So we look at numbers, the percent of us getting a kill off of an out-of-system middle slide compared to just putting up to our outside, we would set it outside every single time. And so, you can train it, but you have to look at the numbers. So one thing which we talked about yesterday, but I'm going to reinforce today, for us, out of system and in system is kind of like a personal preference. So my in system is going to look completely different. Then Sarah's in system. Okay. So, I mean, like, where the height of the set, how close it is to the net. For us, if we only have one option, like if we feel like we can only really do one thing, we'll call that out of system. We tell our hitters, you have to go as hard as you can, hit as hard as you can, deep cross. Don't care what you see, you need to go deep cross. If you're like truly out of system, like I'm in trouble, I can only do one thing. If you feel that you can do multiple things, and we want you to tap the edges of the block. And for small hitters, that's really effective because you're gonna have big blocks in front of them and used to hitting up. And if you can get their eyes working to hitting edges, going to score a lot of tools, they're going to go between the block a ton and be really effective for you. But it has to be intentional because it is really hard for the hitters to put their eyes on the block instead of chasing the ball. But that's how we train our outside. So we tell them, you know, this ball nice and high, like it might be in system for, you know, our number one, it might be out of system for our number five, it's the exact same ball. But I mean, that's how I train. And then in system, if you have really big middles, I would push them a lot.
Can you explain the difference there? How you push the middle,
how system when it's center, center, center? I love bump slide. Yeah, I mean the two ways you could do it is your libero could bump the slide, which I still think is a really low number. Or if your setter gets pulled off the net, so your setter is here, okay, you can have the slide run underneath her. So if Ryan be on the middle. So if I'm in system and Ryan's my middle and he's running the slide, you know, the seven arm slide, he'll go. If I get pulled off, he can run the slide underneath, and then I will set. Like a right side ball and the middle will have to go and chase. I've seen a lot of teams in Saginaw do that and do it really effectively.
You could also run the two ball, which is a higher five in the middle. If your middle is able to run a high ball, we got obliterated by a team that did that. Best player on the team, really long, they kept feeding her the ball and we just couldn't defend it. She hit a really high point, so she would come off of that right and come off of that. You get a setter. She could just feed her the ball up high and she'd go after it. And that's a nice option. But if so you can definitely incorporate without running a faster tempo middle, and that is a really tough ball because for whatever reason it's a phenomenon. It's very tough to defend a two ball or a five ball in the middle because you have angles you can train your kids to hit. And if you've got a great blocker on one side, you probably aren't going to have two very good blockers to take away an angle. That's tough too. So that could be something you can do as well.
Yeah.
Does that resonate?
Oh, one last thing that's going off of that. When we look at the numbers, the amount of times that libero actually has to set during the game is actually pretty small. So to ask her to do multiple things, like multiple different things, the amount of training that you need to be effective running the slide, I mean, you're going to do it like once a match. Having the setter get pulled off to like 12, 13, 14 feet, keeping her hands on it, running the middle high would be a viable option.
Does anybody have a back row attack option? That would be something.
We got all the time.
There's other sessions starting in the gym if you want. Otherwise, we can answer any other questions.
Yeah. So I coached JV, so I know from last week's meeting, I think everything's different, but I've seen it in a couple different ways of people running out of system, their outsides. So I see like the farther the pass is off the net, the farther the wider it comes off. I've seen teams where they just kind of run the same amount of time and what.
Yep.
I feel like I know it depends on the personality you say.
Just if you can share the angles, because this is something that there's no right or wrong or whatever works for your student athlete. Do you want to share the angles of how they approach?
We try to have our out of system set die slightly inside all the the time, so we don't have our girls running out. We do talk about them, the depth being something really, really important. So if, for instance, Justin's my center, Justin, can you come to the 10-foot line? We want to get our out-of-system girls back right about to this area here, but if he gets pulled back, and he comes back and we have a barrel or somebody that's back this far, we also talk about them getting as deep as they are, up to 20 feet, because this allows that ability to lead. And I mean, we would also, that's where he's saying, this is probably a situation where you want to just focus on them driving the ball deep. But we don't have them wide now for the simple fact, I mean, unless you have somebody that's running straight at you, and that would probably be like a, I just know that there's no way they're going to be able to drop the ball in front, and they may widen out a little bit to keep the ball in front, just to keep it in play. But the depth, I think, is more important than the getting out wide, if that kind of makes sense. I mean, it might get pushed back, but I mean, we just have the attacker get as deep as that person's setting, up to 20 feet, because that allows them to have the ability to lead in front. Okay. If I go and I come back to right here, and Justin's way back there, that makes the amount of space that ball is going to come here. Like, if I go and take an approach, it's really tight, or if it's off the net, I'm going to take a two-step approach, and I'm going to be right here. So we really encourage depth more than getting wide.
That's a great question. That's great. All kids are going to get some different answers based on who's coaching them in what year.
Side, and that's probably a harder ball to the outside, so I don't know.